coming to attack us. It's coming to attack us. It's coming to attack us. Whoa! No, 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 no. Does it attack? It's above you. It's attacking you. It's attacking you. It's attacking you.
Why in the world did we try this? In today's video, we survived 100 days in Minecraft. Except there's 4 of us. Let's get you accustomed. There's Bite, Monkey, Harry, and of course me. If one of us gives up, then the challenge is over. A couple goals in this video is to successfully infiltrate an abyss cult, reach past the sea of corpses, and finally escape without getting permanently cursed. Can we pull this off without giving up? Watch till the end to find out. Also, thank you guys so much for 80,000 subscribers. 20,000 away, baby. So if you could hit that subscribe button, it'll mean the world to me. Finally, hit the like button for the algorithm and let's get straight into it. Day 1. We were gonna go straight into it. Our goal is to reach the very bottom of this abyss. It's a pretty straightforward task, except for the fact that we were hindrances to ourselves. But you'll see more of that later on in the video. The first thing that my friends decide to do is jump off of a cliff. Both of them. Yep, just off they go, I guess. Once they respawned, we were right back onto it. The thing about this abyss is that it's not a simple, straightforward, just jump to the straight bottom. There are actually 5 different layers, and potentially a 6th one as well. And that is exactly where we're headed. Ain't no looking back now. We were on our way down. There was a little bit of a pathway that they provided us, so we decided to take that route. Oh, and there's this really cool climb ability. We're basically able to climb up blocks, just for a limited amount of time. We didn't really put it much to use, because, you know, we were kind of cracked at the game anyways. But, you know, it's there. Days 2 to 10. And so we enter the first layer and the first section of this bottomless pit. This zone was called the Edge of the Abyss. It was a total of 1,350 meters deep. This was no joke. And this thing, when I tell you that this thing is steep, I mean it. Hey, no jokes here. This thing is deadly. We noticed that there was a bit of a broken down tree, and we decided to head straight over there. We needed a bunch of wood to make tools, supplies, and everything else. And so we stocked up a bit. Despite me having a bunch of food, I also needed to bless up the boys, so I started collecting some wheat as well. Luckily, this was a lot easier for us. We ended up finding someone's house with a humongous farm. What a blessing. Ain't nobody starving today. One of the most major things that you need to know is basically beds are your best friend. They are going to allow you to set your spawn point wherever you die. So we needed a bunch of those and I started collecting some. To scale this first layer, luckily for us, there were a lot of bases and a lot of staircases that led down a little bit. We just went base by base and tried getting ourselves down as safely as possible in the very beginning. As we carried on exploring, I eventually found myself some iron. Now this was going to be big because the most I had was stone tools, and eventually that was just not going to cut it. Psych, it was in an area where I couldn't mine, so it was basically useless. Took the L on that one. I got memed by the game, y'all. This ain't cool. Monkey, on the other hand, was in need of a bunch of cobblestone, and what I decided to do was kind of mess around with them. I didn't let him get much cobble, and I kind of took it for myself. Hey, it's all fair game, okay? Finders keepers. This is when some of the pathways downwards were not existent anymore, and we kind of had to scale downwards. This was a bit of a problem, but I decided to also test out the climbing feature. It went pretty smoothly before realizing that once I lose stamina, I get slowness. That's not good. After realizing that that strategy is basically pointless, we decided to start block clutching our way down. Slowly but surely, we didn't want to lose too much health, and if we died, we'd have to spawn all the way back at the top. Didn't want that happening. No, sir. New section alert. We found another person's base. Now, when I tell you that there's a massive amount of signs here, there's a massive amount of signs here. Is that even the terminology for it? I don't even know. But basically, let's just say that a bunch of people wanted to put their names on a sign and give a little bit of a message to the people that come by this place, which is us. We're the people coming down and never being able to come back up. Anywho, the important part is that we got a bunch of food, and trust me, guys, we are going to need food to tackle some of the lower layers because these layers are deadly without food. So we basically just started collecting a bunch of munchies. While we were all collecting wheat, Monkey almost fell into a gap within the farm. We checked it out, and that thing honestly could have killed him. While I was getting some work done and crafting up the bread that I needed to survive, these two decided to play some spleef on the other hand and almost killed each other. Like, bro, we're supposed to be working together on this. As if for those two to be at their throats wasn't bad enough, they decided to bring me along with it and almost spleefed Mia. Like, bro, why? What for? There's no need for this. Now, here's where things get a little interesting, because I read up on a sign that basically told me if I go down a path, I'll be able to go down faster. This didn't really make a lot of sense to me, because the only way down would be from the sides, and this thing goes straight to the middle. title. I was thinking in the back of my head that it might take us to the other side of the gap, because that would make a lot more sense. So I decided to take my leap of faith. We arrived at a room with a singular bed, a hole in the floor, and it kind of looked like someone's base in the middle of the pit. This is very confusing because we did not know why it was there and how it would help us go down faster, because upon looking at the hole and inspecting it, it just went straight down. Bite managed to keep track of the direction and the place that I went to, but Monkey on the other hand didn't, and we had to help him get back to us. Once Monkey realized the pathway that we took, he was questioning everything. Like, man really said, why the heck and why in the world would you guys go into the center of a bottomless pit to get down faster? Like, bro, y'all got a death wish or something? All we told him was trust us, you know, we had a plan, so sort of. Once Monkey finally arrived, we decided to use him as our lab rat. We didn't know what this actually was, and we needed someone to go dive down. It was not gonna be me, and Bite wasn't having it either. Monkey, on the other hand, didn't even think twice about it. He just leaped. He's like, yeah, you know, I got my bed back there. No, he didn't. He didn't even right-click the bed. So when this man died, he went straight back to spawn, and we had to wait for him. This process took a while, because not only did he have to come to the section in the layer that we were at, but he also needed to find the coordinates, and it happened that he was kind of on the opposite end, so he had to walk all the way around, which was pain, by the way. I decided to buy some McDonald's while I waited, and at last, Monkey had finally made it back to the place. He actually this time right-clicked the bed so his spawn point saved there, and he wanted to give it another go because he thought of a really good plan. And there he goes again, try two. So the interesting thing about this method is it actually works. Monkey made it to the bottom and set his spawn point there, but the way it works is a little confusing. So basically, right, clutches like water buckets, boat, any sort of clutch, it does not work because it registers the amount of height that you jumped off from and deals you that damage. But with the mechanic of the bed saving your spawn point, if you right-click fast enough on your way down, your new spawn point will be that bed. And so that gives you instant access, and that gives you access to the next section. And on the first try, your boy made it. What did you expect? Come on now. And right when I arrived, Monkey started spleefing me, so I just booked it back to the mainland. Bite in this situation was actually AFK, so we decided to collect some resources while we waited for him. Days 11 to 20. After a little bit of a mining trip and me completely wasting a lot of the wood that I had to build as if I was playing Bed Wars, we decided to take another leap. It worked the first time, so it had to work the second time, right? Nope, I died. And Monkey died. I'm not sure why we did this, but we decided to spend a lot of time here, because instead of going the normal way where we could just scale the side of, you know, the bottomless pit, we decided to use the bed method again on a bed that wasn't even meant as an elevator system. It was just a random bed that we found, and we're like, hey, I think we can make it. If we do, we can skip an entire layer. So let's give it a shot. Death after death after death after death after. You get the point. This was a pretty loop process. And even the other people on the server started questioning us. They're like, yo, you good? It was ridiculous. But eventually, both me and Bite managed to do the bed jump. Monkey, on the other hand, was having a little bit of a hard time. So we had to build up a bit and create him a bit of a platform so he could right-click the bed a little easier since it was a bit higher. But at the end of the day, all three of us managed to do the bed clutch, which was good. Afterwards, I found a sign that said this is the way down, so I decided to take a leap and basically broke my legs. But oh well, we just still decided to keep going. Me and Monkey decided to head down slowly but surely because we wanted to play it safe, take the most minimal amount of damage, and that was basically the goal that we were trying to accomplish here. And then Bite jumps off of a cliff and dies because he tried water bucket clutching. Good job, Bite. You know, it's whatever, we'll just wait for him. He has a bed up there and he'll be here soon, right? I looked up and I saw that we were not alone. This is our first encounter with one of the creatures that lives in the abyss. It was colored blue, and it was flying straight towards us. Now, if you guys didn't know, these things are exponentially stronger than normal Minecraft mobs, and we would probably be best to avoid them at all costs, but this was the first time encountering one, so we were just kind of looking at it. Luckily for us, we were actually out of its grasp until Monkey decided to further look into it, and it bit Monkey, and he started screaming. It legit took out almost half of his health. He had to straight away start eating something to recover those hearts back, and we quickly went down into cover. Without a second's worth of thought, we quickly went into the next section. We were not gonna stay up there in that section with that bird thing trying to kill us. Shortly after we finally get to the next section, we start collecting some resources waiting for Bite, but Bite gets pushed off by one of these birds and ends up dying once again. Now he's all the way back up there, we gotta wait even longer. As you can see from here, birds weren't the only things that we needed to worry about. In this layer, there were still other things that could have gotten us, and I think the most terrifying of things was the split jaw. If we got caught by a split jaw, it would literally be over for us. Like, if that thing camped us, we'd have to disconnect and wait a while before hopping back on. On our adventures downwards, we found this other system that didn't actually require a bed, So the concept of it was very simple. There was a ladder, and in between the ladder, there were 2 to 3 blocks. So basically, the ladder would catch or fall, and we wouldn't get hurt. Well, sometimes. Sometimes it did hurt. I don't even know why. But honestly, it was a very good method on getting down. There weren't too many of these, and most of them were on the first section. So we wanted to utilize this as much as we could. But when I told the rest of them that I found an elevator, they did not believe me. They thought I was going crazy. Monkey legit wanted to bury me into a hole, as if the elevator wasn't right behind them. Like, come on now. As you can see here, we eventually convinced them that elevators do exist. Well, whatever elevator sort that is. But we started using it to get to the next layer. I think one of the biggest issues with going layer by layer is the fact that each and every layer, we have to find another bed to set our spawn. We didn't want to lose any of the ones that we already had in our inventories, and we wanted those as emergency beds. This layer was a little different than the last one. We couldn't find ourselves a bed anywhere near the top. So what we decided to do was continue going down the elevator. And the one thing that I was trying to avoid at all costs managed to find us. The freaking split jaw. But listen up, if it wasn't for the ladder system, we probably would have been chased by this thing until we were in a cave. We decided to continue going, but as you can see, it got a little stuck on the ladders. But then after we started moving, it started chasing us once again. Eventually we got out of its grasp, and that's all due to the elevator system. We then started moving around looking for another bed, because if we died, we would have had to do all that again. Not to mention the split jaws is already over there, and we didn't want to experience that again. But we did find a bit of a town slash city looking thing in the middle, and decided it'd be a good idea if we checked it out, because you know, when there's a city slash town, there's usually beds, right? While we were taking the pathway to the city slash town, there was actually a bird. Now this bird was different than the last bird that we encountered. This one didn't have a lot of blue on them and honestly looked like a regular bird, except massive. And despite all the red flags that we received from this creature alone and this lair, we decided to just walk past it as if nothing would have gone wrong. Well, to be fair, it was Bite's idea. Me and Monkey kind of wanted to keep going down, but it's, you know, it's whatever. Nope, it wasn't just whatever. Bite started getting chased by the bird, and he ran quickly back along with the rest of us. From then on, we avoided some open places. Instead, we decided to take the enclosed route. So that includes pathways, ways down, and we just started scaling the layer. You know what? Screw the thing in the middle of the place. We just wanted to go to the next layer, okay? We found this bed, but it looked like more of a trap. Luckily, someone already dug out of it. But what we also noticed is that someone trapped, or privated rather, their crafting table. Like, what would we possibly do to your crafting table? Mr. Nobody can touch my crafting table because I don't trust anybody. We weren't even able to use it. Like, not only was it inaccessible, but it was just there taunting us. We didn't want to spend the wood on that. Days 21 to 30, the Forest of Temptation. Just about 1,250 meters to go to get to the next section. We finally made it to the second section. The thing about this section, to simply put it, it's a lot different from the last section. You're not just able to scale them out. Well, kind of, but not really, because the structures and just the terrain here is so much different than the last section. On the bright side, getting through this section is a lot shorter than the last one, except for the fact that we have to go more horizontal than vertical. What that basically means is to reach certain portions, we actually have to go not down, but sideways or straight forward or backwards. And it's a have to. As you can see, this was no easy way of getting down. A lot of the terrain has completely changed up. And also, there are more and more things that we had to fear on these layers. Not to mention, the mobs get stronger and we get health effects the further we go down. We decided to place our very first bed. Now, this one was expendable, okay? We needed to use it. We weren't gonna go back to the next section, all right? We made it to section 2 and we were staying here. We looked below us and there wasn't even ground to bridge down on. So we honestly just needed to find another person's path, and that was our game plan. So we headed over to the first path that we saw. It was kind of like a humongous cliffside. We basically just scaled the side of it up until we found the main land, or what we thought was the main land, when in reality it was just another one of these chunks. In between us and the chunk, there was actually another one of those birds. We tried our very best to avoid it, and we made it to the main land. Once we made it, we started collecting a bunch more resources because we needed that, and started scaling a little bit down. On our way there, we saw a couple signs here and there, just like on the upper layers, except less this time, because probably less and less people made it this far. We are amongst the survivors. Yep, I know, we're pretty cool, aren't we? Bite had almost completely ran out of food. Me, on the other hand, I was doing a little well, but I knew that I needed way more for the lower sections. So we needed to find ourselves another farm. we decided to take a look around this first layer of the section. Upon looking around, we eventually found a house with a bit of a wheat farm. Now, we were interested in going, but we were also wondering if we could find potentially a bigger wheat farm to suffice for all of us. Upon going downwards, we actually found a bit of an orphanage. Now, it seemed like there were like 8+ beds in there. It was kind of strange, but we tried looking for one that we can set our spawns in. And eventually, we did find one. We continued going downwards. Now, something I actually didn't mention in the beginning was flowing water hurts more than static water. And what that basically means is if you jump into flowing water, it'll start hurting you and shoving you out of it, just like any other waterfall would, basically propelling you to the bottom and hurting you at the same time because of all the pressure. We actually found this out the hard way. Well, rest in peace us, we died to waterbenders. Yay. Okay, all jokes aside, on our way down we tried to play it a little bit more safer. Upon looking up to Bite and Monkey, I noticed that above them was another one of those flipping birds. We basically booked it. I jumped down and then the bird was right after me. For some reason, it didn't even look at Bite and Monkey. It was just looking at me. It shoved me into the water and I was so low. I was on the platform right underneath it. The first death in the Forest of Temptation was Monkey. And then shortly afterwards, it was Bite. I was the only one alive. The sole survivor of the group. I quickly ran because the bird was not just disappearing on me. It actually started chasing me down. I decided to block myself into the side of the wall with as many blocks as I could. I left a couple gaps for some reason, but that's because I thought the bird was stuck somewhere. So I was just kind of vibing there as I waited for the rest of them to come back. I decided to take a peek and I saw that the bird was actually stuck in the waterfall. This was good for me, but in the background, all I heard was the other two struggling to get back down because of the amount of split jaws and other things that were just roaming about the place. Their spawn rates are probably also increased, so this made it like double the difficulty. This is where things took a turn for the worse. Cause while I was waiting for them, I was a little bit AFK and a split jaw snuck up on me and bit my head off. What made it even worse is that Monkey and Bite finally got to me. Finally, they saw me. They saw me get my head bit off. I was back in their situation, in their shoes. I was trying to get back to that same location that they were trying to get to. We were all trying to meet back over there. Unluckily for me, there was so much stuff, just creatures all over the place. And every single time I tried going down there, I ended up dying again and again and again. It was legit spawn camping from a split jaw. It sucked. But luckily for the other two, they managed to find a cave of safety where they hid. They also distracted one of the split jaws, so that made it a little bit easier for me to finally reunite with them. We also decided to start mining a little bit because we were lacking of iron, so that's exactly what we did. Unluckily, iron rates and iron spawn amounts were actually lowered. There was about like 1 to 2 pieces each vein, and it honestly made things so much harder. Eventually, we decided to leave the cave once and for all and continue heading downwards. We were not only looking for a bed but also food, because we were running out of that stuff pretty quickly. As we went down, we once again found another one of these houses. We decided to check it out, but there was a lot of claim stuff, so we decided to leave. But shortly afterwards, there was once again another bird that we had aggroed, so we decided to try our best to ignore it, but it wasn't going too well. Our strategy out of it was pretty solid though. Run for our lives. That was all we had. There's nothing else to it. And finally, we got past the first layer of the Forest of Temptation. So many more to go. Most of the beds that we came by were also claimed, which really sucked because we couldn't set our spawn points anywhere near. Our last spawn was still in that little orphanage area. So dying was not something on the agenda this time around. It didn't take too long before we finally found an accessible bed and I told the others about it. We also started running out of ways to actually get down, so we decided to start doing some risky maneuvers for some reason, but that was probably because we got a bed. You know, we were able to do these risky maneuvers and we were able to trial and error things until one thing worked. Well, to be fair, they all kind of worked, but it was just one is more efficient than the other. Okay, we were just messing around. But as usual, this terrain is different from the last one, and the terrain, or at least its vertical terrain, just completely stopped and went into a halt. We had to go around and find another one of those bridges that led us onto different land that actually goes downwards. Again, mind you. So that's exactly what we did. Days 31 to 40. After a long walk, we eventually found a bit of a bridge that led to the side of the entire place. This legitimately led to the bottom, so this was a good sign. That means we can actually scale it. There was a bit of a pattern that we were noticing with these kind of areas. A lot of the middle areas are very, very short. And a lot of the sides are basically just the things that take it down, because at the end of the day, it is just a gigantic abyss, and it's shaped like a circle, which means the sides, most of the time, have a way to get down. Eventually, we got into a new layer and found a cross, which happened to be at one of the centers of the abyss. It was on this strange island, and it kind of looked cool, actually. This layer was a little different than the last layers, because this layer actually had bamboo on it. It was either something that naturally spawned or something that other people decided to plant there. Regardless of how it got there, it still looked pretty sick. Eventually, we also found one of the things that we really wanted, which was more food. I was at 29 bread. I ain't trying to starve here, okay? We got sections to get through. Come on, people. But yeah, we stacked up a bit. We got a bit more food. We eventually ended up on one of the layers, which was a little bit flatter than the rest of them. And that's because we were actually able to go a bit horizontal. Not only this, but we also found a structure that was a little bit bigger than most of the structures on the side of the walls. This was a first. This confused us a bit, actually, because some of the containers there that was locked were also shulker boxes. How did they get shulker boxes? Is there even an end here? Our best guess was during events, so that probably made the most sense. Me and Monkey decided to climb one of the trees to further scout out the area, and further in the distance, we found a little bit of a thing that kind of looked like a hub of some sorts that led to different builds and different communities. And obviously, due to our curiosity, your boy had to check it out, come on now. But in the meantime, while Bite was trying to get up on the tree in the first place, he started getting attacked by some bug. We barely could even see it, so we decided to scurry quickly. Once we arrived at the place we saw in the distance, we realized that it was an entire civilization. There were multiple communities living here. It was mad. And at the dead center of everything, we found a huge array of signs. As usual with any place, there's obviously a lot of people that want to, you know, write down their names so they'll be remembered. And this was one of those areas. Now you might be wondering, hey Adrien, why didn't you put down your name on the sign? Or Monkeys, or Bites, or anyone else that's playing with you? Well, because we were aiming bigger, okay? We were aiming bigger than anybody else on the server. We wanted to get to the very bottom and then put our signs down there. And then put our names down there, alright? Not these whack signs. They're lame. So at this very moment, my friends decided to use this little bit of a tactic called climbing down vines on an empty void. I told them that it was gonna go wrong. Did they listen? Absolutely not. They just decided to go down the vines, and lo and behold, a bird decided to attack them mid-fall. So they were kind of screwed, I'm not gonna lie. And I stand above them, up there, in safety, by the way, watching them fall into their demise and get attacked by birds. But on the way down that Monkey took, he actually witnessed something that he was super hyped to show me. So I'm like, okay, let's check out what it was, right? So I decided to give in and decided to go down the vines and check it out for myself. And on the way down, I saw an incredible build. Okay, when I just look at this, take a look at the clip. Yep, you guys saw that right. It was incredible. We almost made it. So without any wasted time, we decided to start rushing down. There was a bit of a staircase that Bite found, and we decided to take that down. Or so I thought I was gonna do, but instead I decided to take some vines down. Once we finally reached the bottom of the little chunk that we were on, we found out that there was a huge upside down forest. And that's what we were using to figure out how to get down. It was very confusing because there was no clear cut way out. And we thought we had to go to some of the edges of the map, or just that section in general, just so we can get down and check out the builds. We were determined as heck to check out the build that we saw on our way down from the vines, and we were not stopping until we figured it out. Unluckily for us, we got lost, but eventually I met up with Monkey, and Bite was busy getting food. I'm not sure what he was doing, honestly, but we all had the same goal in mind, which was to get to that build no matter what the situation. So that's what exactly we were all putting our mind to. Monkey was dying from hunger. Bite needed food. I needed food. So we all needed a break, all right? This was going to be it. Once we got into that building, I bet you there's an entire farm system in there. Well, at least it seems like it, because it looks like a freaking palace. Eventually, we managed to see the actual floor. We knew where and how far the actual goal was. We were looking at some of the vines and considering if we could fall down from them, but honestly, none of them seemed to look doable. Days 41 to 50. Eventually, after walking all of that distance, we at last found a building, a structure actually, that went from top to bottom. We could go down into that thing and reach the very surface where we need to go anyways, just to get down another section. At last, we finally made it to the structure. Once we entered, we quickly decided to look for a bed, because we were not going through that once again. Something that was even better is on our way down, we found ourselves a water elevator, and we took that all the way to the bottom. Lo and behold, we were finally at the ground floor of that layer. And the acres of food, crops, and everything you could ever ask for when it comes to health regeneration was right in front of us. It was a miracle. It honestly was. If it wasn't for this, we probably would have just ended up quitting. Because this was not an easy task, guys. This was actually difficult. What was even worse is some of the creatures from the lower section made it to the top section somehow and started chasing us around. That was a little chaotic, but luckily we avoided most of them. We were going for the Undertale pacifist route. We also then found out that one of the creatures were rideable. So we all decided to ride the same creature for some reason, and we all ended up dying. Very counterproductive, if you ask me. But listen, okay, we were just trying things out, okay? You can't even blame us. It looked cool. Like, imagine riding around in one of these velociraptor-looking things. Like, who wouldn't want to do that? I meant pterodactyl. Not velociraptor. Yeah. And finally, we managed to get out of this section. The next section was called the Great Fault. This was around 4,400 meters down. That's almost double the amount of the last two. Like, that is an insane drop. But that didn't stop us. We continued to carry on scaling this abyss. The thing about this place is it's somewhat a little bit easier, but also harder to scale down because it takes the concept of just being able to go straight down through different pathways, block clutching, and, you know, just bases all around. But it also takes a bit of a steeper take on it because there are no cliff sides. There are no pieces of land that we can just stand on besides the ones that are player built. So this place was dangerous, okay? If you fall, you're gonna fall until you suffocate in the air. Or fall on someone's base, that too. Another issue with this place is that there were actually no pieces or signs of life anywhere. At least the natural kind, because there were, in fact, a couple farms here and there, but there was no grass. There was no sign of trees. How are we gonna get wood? And there were honestly a lack of a lot of materials, but we were prepared for this, okay? We stacked up on food, all right? We were set. We kept pacing forwards a few layers below, and we eventually reached this place, which was a bit of a cavern. This cavern was within the marble masses. Like, I don't even know how I got there. But honestly, there were trees in there. It was a little bit of a biosphere, as I like to call it. But there were also creatures in there, so we had to be careful a little bit. But looking around inside, it looked pretty cool. We looked around because there might have been something special in there. Maybe like someone's base, someone's valuable items, per se, but we ended up finding not much. Maybe a couple blocks here and there, but that was about it. There was also one of these bird creatures that we found up there. Well, right at the beginning of the section at least. And they were just kind of roaming around. We tried our very best avoiding them because they did not look fun to mess with. Now, this is when we found something that would have helped us if we found out in the very beginning. And that's the fact that someone custom built an entire staircase that leads to the next bit. And we completely overlooked it because of the fact that we were fascinated over builds. Yeah, you know what? I'm not even surprised. You know, that basically sounds like us. We quickly went over to the staircase and started utilizing it. This made things twice as fast, but again, this was double the section size as the other sections, which was ridiculous. So even with this, it was still a pretty slow process. Also, remember the sign thing that people like doing at really crucial moments or like positions within the abyss? Yeah, that there was a lot of these. There were actually quite a few of these all over the staircase. On our way down, we were just looking at all of the cool builds that we saw all over the place. Also, every bed we found, we tried by clicking because obviously we need to set a spawn point just in case we got jumped by something like a split jaw, you know? We didn't want that happening. Once again, further down into the layers, we found another thing that was underground. Now, this one looked a lot more sophisticated. It looked like there was an entire community living within this place. And I couldn't blame them. This actually looked sick. And it was probably a really good protection against all the split jaws outside and another one of those bird-like creatures. So this was honestly very clever. We were just looking around and didn't really do much here because there wasn't much that they could offer without their chests being locked, of course. So, you know. Eventually, we also found a bit of a ship. Now, this ship was not normal, okay? It was not made out of wood. You know what this thing was made out of? Andesite? Which one was it? The white one. That's what it was made out of, okay? I honestly thought I would have found some, like, secret treasure or something, but also nothing. But we kept going. I was actually ahead of most of everyone else, so I tried pulling a prank on them, but I couldn't quite finish by the time they saw it, and they eventually just jumped over it. I almost got bite, though, to be fair, okay? I almost got him. We'll get him next time. It didn't take too long before we found, once again, another massive city with some crazy-looking builds. Now, this was also incredible, almost as incredible as all the other builds, except this time it looked pretty interesting because the contrast between the buildings and the terrain that we were in was pretty drastic. What was even crazier is, you know, this is kind of a thing that repeats throughout the sections, but there was something in the very middle of the abyss, again, that was near the city that looked very sick, and we decided to check it out. It looked cool at first, but it wasn't very practical, and didn't really, it was nothing. It was just decoration, and we decided to just head back to the staircase. I kept moving forward and kept my head up as well. Lo and behold, before I knew it, I was eventually at the next section. I was one of the first people here, amongst our group, not with all of the players, just amongst our group. This section was known as the Goblets of Giants, which approximately was about 5,000 meters. That's how far we had to go just to get to the next section. That sounds like a very, very painful experience. Also, why is it even called the Goblets of Giants? Are there giants here? Like, we had no idea what to expect, honestly. I was a bit ahead, so I waited for the rest of them once I found a bed. It's what I wanted to do, but let's just say that they were having a couple difficulties with their connection and stuff. So I decided to move on ahead. I'd meet them in a lower layer. The first thing that I noticed on the layer that I was at the moment is the fact that there was also another city slash town thing. Now, the thing about this is that the area was actually filled with these huge, gigantic, I guess you could call them flowers. What would you even call these things? It's these giant stems with a huge circle at the top that's filled with water. I don't know what to call these things. Let's just call them spas, okay? I hopped from one spa to the next spa, and honestly, there were a couple of staircases around, a bunch of blocks in the water, and a bunch of pathways that I could have taken. Also, take a look at the ceiling of the area that I'm in. I don't even know what to think about it. Like, what is that? Today's 51 to 60. Eventually, we hit one of the towns that are a little bit lower than the one we initially were at. I tell you what this town is named, but I have no freaking idea. In that very town, there was also a public ender chest where I had a bunch of blocks. This would help me block clutch my way down on some of the parts. Not all of them, obviously. And it honestly didn't take too long before we continued heading further and further down below. To my surprise, there were also a bunch of areas that had a bunch of ladders and a bunch of beds just all over the place. You know, the lower we get, you'd expect the less and less life would actually be there, but surprisingly, this area had a bunch of life around. Every house that we also came by, I decided to take a look inside of it just in case one of the chests was, you know, by accident open. I don't know, I just needed some more materials, and you know, if it was there, I might as well grab something from there. What caught my attention was this one house on top of the water that was a little bit closer to the middle than the side. It looked pretty nice, actually. Whoever built it did a pretty good job. But what was more important about it was the fact that there was a bunch of food right next to it. That's exactly what I needed. Not only this, but I also realized that a lot of the ginormous trees that were all over the place could have also been used to scale down, because I started block clutching on them and going branch to branch. And with each and every layer, I decided to get more and more confident with some of these block clutches. Yeah, boy was feeling it. What can I say? You know, I'm cracked. It didn't take too long before we find this huge platform. I have no idea what this platform is. Like, in all honesty, it seemed very extra because almost all of it was not in use. It was just a bunch of torches so that things don't spawn on there. I'm not sure. I have no idea what the purpose of this place is. We decided to carry on. We found this little bit of a structure that had an enchantment table in it. I really wanted to use it. I had 21 levels and nothing, literally nothing, to put it on. But regardless, I still wanted to enchant something, so it was a bummer that it was claimed. I would like to say around halfway into the layer itself, we started seeing a whole bunch of these ice glaciers. They were really random because, like, the fact that there was glaciers right next to fully grown trees was honestly one of the most bizarre things I've seen as far. And obviously, the farther we went down, the harder it got to actually scale this place. Luckily for us, the spawn rates, for some reason, we lucked out on that. There were no mobs in sight for this time being, okay, just for now, and we were honestly really lucky because of that. Eventually, at some point, the land below us was actually just non-existent, and I had to take a pathway that led me straight to the middle of the abyss. I know it sounds dumb, but listen, okay, hear me out. On the other side was the way down, so we needed to check it out. On the way there, though, I did find this one strange looking structure. I didn't know how to explain it really. I honestly went to check it out and I think it was a throne room, but on our way there we got attacked by a bird. But little did he know, I had a shield and it had no match for me. Decimated. That's what happened to him. Got decimated. That's actually a pretty cool word. We kept going down the path and eventually found this place where we could use as a bit of a highway. And that's simply because it was set up in the way that SMP Nether highways are, where you use a boat and slide it across ice with gaps in between it. It was honestly very efficient, and it got us to some interesting places, like this lovely city, these buildings over here. Hey, look at that thing. That's pretty cool, right? Upon first entering the area, I fell off and had to do all that again. But we'll just skip over that just so you guys don't get bored. Day 61 to
65.
This place honestly looked sick. It was, in comparison to all the builds I saw up there, this by far had to be one of the coolest things, probably side by side as that one structure that we climbed down around like a section or two ago. It was a bit of a struggle getting down from one layer to the next with this bit because I did see a couple safer ways to get down, but I decided to take a bit of a riskier route and climb down the statue. Why did I do that? I don't know. But listen, okay, it was kind of fun, I'm not gonna lie. We kept going at it up until it worked, alright? It kind of started feeling like ReZero at some point. At the place we were at, I also noticed that there was a bit of a beacon. The beacon had a lot of iron, and let's just say your boy wasn't doing too well in the iron department. So we started looting it. By the way, after I was done with the recording, this is the reason why they banned me from the server for griefing. I'm sorry. This kept happening, and I didn't want to make the same trick back to this very location. So I decided to place down one of my limited beds, by the way, and place it over there. This way, even if I did die, I could just respawn back up here and try again. Alright, this was just to make things a little bit simpler. Once I did finally get to the next layer, I noticed that there was a little bit off with the entire section, honestly. The ice started taking over more than the ground itself, and the ice actually led us to the next town. There was a miniature town at the bottom of that huge town above us, and I wanted to check that out too, just in case there was some goodies like the last town had. There wasn't much, honestly, but we decided to pack our things and head further down. Finally, after scaling glacier after glacier after glacier, and just going across a bunch of really risky bridges and whatnot, we finally found something that looked kind of promising. So do you guys know what this thing is? Some of you guys might, some of you guys might not. So basically what it is called a blue vine. Now this thing is supposed to be a bit of an elevator down throughout each of these layers, which made this layer so much easier. Or so we think. Nothing ever goes right when I say that. You know, for the first bit, it was actually pretty normal. We were just going down, we were just having fun, you know, just witnessing the area. But the problem with this situation is when we reach the next layer, the routes that was supposed to take us down all the way to the bottom were gone. Someone decided to break them and thought it was funny to do so. And so I was left falling aimlessly to my death. Good job, you know, to whoever did that. Amazing. Amazing joke. I decided to use my big brain because I didn't want to go all the way back up and find a different direction. So instead, I realized that there were a couple checkpoints in between and decided to block clutch on one of them. Look at how low my hearts were when I actually did it. We did this all the way down until there were more vines that we can go down. And that's what we decided to take down up until we hit the bottom of wherever we were at, honestly. There was a huge town here, but it looked very barren. It didn't seem like a lot of people lived here, but the structure was definitely here. It might have been ruins, to be honest, now that I look back at it. After checking out the surrounding area, I then soon realized that there are gaps on the floor in the center building. The reason why this is important is it leads us to the next section that we need to get to. Now, I'm not gonna lie to you guys, this section is one of my favorite sections. Why? It's because it just sounds cool, to be honest. So I did what any sane person would do, jump into the abyss of water. Duh. There was a huge gap in the middle, and honestly, there was also a little bit of a system to get down, but I didn't really want to use that. I wanted to see how the original people that first discovered this place attempted getting down. And that was just aimlessly going downwards within the water. I saw some platforms on the sides as well, and I wanted to try seeing if I could land in some of them. But oh god, was that a mistake. I just kept dying left and right. It was honestly, what was I thinking? I died so many times that I need to place a bet because I needed to respawn right here. I did not want to make a walk every single time that I died. Day
66
to 70. This section is known as the Sea of Corpses. Estimated to around 1,000 meters, but let me tell you, the reason it's only 1,000 meters is because of how severe this place is. It's not fun, and honestly, it's one of the most devastating layers or sections that exists, besides obviously the sixth one. One of the main reasons of this is because of the simple fact that there's only certain locations on the map where you can actually progress through, alright? Most of it is just ocean, and it's not even a full ocean. They are chunks of water, as you can see here, while I'm walking across this bridge. I kid you not, I went acre to acre, literally all across the place. I tried following this path because they had to start somewhere, right? And they had to eventually lead to somewhere else. So I was really adamant on finding that exact place. But eventually, I just kept seeing another ocean after another ocean after another ocean right above our heads. It was one of the most weirdest sights, yo. Eventually, I finally found a way down. I decided to set my bed on one of the pathways just in case I decided to fall and completely lose all the progress that I've already made. Not only this, but I wanted to see what was below me. Was there more ocean? Was there land that I could bed clutch on? there was more ocean, but in between the ocean and where I was, you know, going to the bottom of the layer, there is a bunch of air, which meant fall damage. Great. One of the interesting things about this area is once I was finally done doing a bunch of trial and error, I eventually found myself on this little bit of a platform. Now, this thing was weird, okay? It wasn't a staircase. It was definitely not some sort of a block clutch thing, but it was a bit of a pathway and it was a bunch of falling with no damage actually taken. It's hard to explain, but just look at it. Eventually, at the very bottom, we finally got to some sort of an island. There was actually someone living here. No, they're not actually on, but you know, there was a bit of a building here and a bunch of stuff here and a campsite, which was kind of cool to see, but nothing that was useful to us. So we decided to keep going. I eventually found a pathway and I decided to follow it because eventually it would lead somewhere, right? I was right, it eventually led us to the place that had land on it. Okay, not just an island, I mean full on land that we can scale and go down. This was big. And oh my god, was I happy when I found this. Like, this thing was actually such a blessing because I had no idea how I was going to scale to the bottom because I've never even been this far down. And you know, just when I thought everything was going according to plan and that I was just simply gonna go down with that, you know, piece of land, it decided to just completely end. There was nothing underneath it. There's a pathway. I decided to take the pathway, but above us was a huge chunk of island or whatever it was, and there was literally no clear-cut way of getting down. So I just aimlessly walked down this path hoping for the very best. Day 71 to 80. I'm gonna keep it real with you guys. This duration of time was honestly the worst for me because I did not know where to go. My friends were still in the section above me, by the way, still trying to get themselves down. It was looking very hopeless. I decided on one of the platforms that I found on that bridge, I put down a bed and decided to drop down to see if I could maybe just potentially luck out and that there was something I could bed clutch on besides one measly path. Another one, by the way. There was nothing there. It was looking bad. And lo and behold, after all of the time wasted finding this thing, we finally found ourselves a staircase. Let's go. That's what I'm talking about. It obviously led to the path below it, but I did notice that there was some land nearby, and I was actually excited about that. After reaching there, what I was more excited about was the fact that there was a minecart system, which meant we could ride our way down into the lower levels, hopefully. That's at least what I thought. And obviously, we created a minecart with the limited iron that we had just so we can ride a whip down this thing. I think this was a really good decision, you know? This was a really good investment, if I do say so myself. You know, I'm quite the master of stonks. What the minecart led to was actually just like lower and lower levels, but what I did discover was that there was a snowy biome on this section. This was actually surprising to me because I did not expect there to be wood or any trees or any life forms around here, especially when the place is called Sea of Freaking Corpses. Like, what? All right, and I think I almost forgot to mention that every time we're actually on this section of the world, we get this strange effect that happens to our health. Remember the thing that I said in the very beginning? The further down we go, the harder the mobs get and the harder that it actually hits our internal organs and everything. Yeah, well, let's just say that this section is trying to kill us off. The scary part about this is that it just keeps getting worse. Like, it takes out half of my health just in general. But I found out that if we just stay in one zone and not move around too much, it actually doesn't affect us. So what I decided to do was actually live in this biome, waiting for the rest of them to catch up to me. I took this time to actually build myself a house. Now, this is where we basically just decided to build, and this is what the house looks like. After obviously a long freaking waiting period, they finally made it to the base. But the first person that came wasn't actually Monkey or Bite. It was my friend Harry. He joined us on this adventure a little while ago, but he was all the way at the top, so we kind of let him come down on his own. But on his way down, he actually made friends with one of my friends called Bagsy Boy. Kid's a bit of a menace, but we'll get to that later. After Harry got here, it didn't take too long for Bite to finally appear, but Monkey was nowhere to be seen. But the fact that 3/4 of us were already here, I decided to help Harry build one of his houses, and Bite built his own. Not to mention, we also started setting up wells for some reason. I don't even know. During this duration of time, I also decided to go mining a little bit, get myself some diamonds. Bite also wanted to do some mining. We collected a bunch of wood around the nearby area, but not too close or else it would have made it look kind of ugly. And Harry also started working on a farm for us. That way we can be self-sufficient around here. During this duration, we also got attacked by more of those bird things. And honestly, it was really annoying. We eventually had to kill them off, and that's exactly what we did. That and hidden houses. You know, it was kind of a mixture between the two. I am not going to be specific specifying which one we did more of, but I think you guys can guess. Despite Monkey not being here, we were not gonna let that stop us, and we decided to carry on. We kept going down. Eventually, we find these really cool ice spikes that were kind of curved. It was a little bit strange, but it was still pretty sick nonetheless. At least on the bright side, instead of the lousy iron armor that I had before, now I have a diamond chestplate and diamond pants. Like, I mean, now this part was actually super fun for me, at least. The primary thing that I did was ride the rails all the way to where it led, and the rest of them actually walked. So I was just chilling, you know, I was vibing in my whip. Eventually, we finally found ourselves at someone's base. Now this base looked absolutely sick. Like, look at this place. The water was just dropping down, and their base were on these little floating islands, which also looked freaking amazing. We decided to invade it because honestly, it looked very flourished. They looked like they had a lot of resources, and we were in need of some resources. One of the most important things that we found in this place was actually their enchantment table. I decided to start killing some of their animals, but I didn't kill them off to a point where they couldn't reproduce, so I kept two in each pen. But I needed the EXP just so I can enchant my diamond armor. This helped out so much later on because we didn't realize how important it actually was. But besides that, we honestly just took some food and just explored the rooms that they had because this base was really sick. So props to whoever made this. Days 81 to 99. Eventually, after we were all looted up from everything we needed from the place, I also decided to take some of their books because, I don't know, maybe I wanted to enchant something later on. And we could potentially make our own enchantment table so we don't need to keep bothering this place. To be fair, we decided to continue following the rails because that was kind of one of the only places that led us to these cool findings. So I was like, you know what, why not? They obviously lead somewhere, right? In the midst of this, we also managed to lose Harry. I don't know where he went. It was actually starting to feel a little weird, as if we were being watched or something. First Monkey disappeared and now Harry. I had no idea what was going on, but it wasn't gonna stop me from reaching the bottom. All right, if they get caught slacking, that's on them. That's not my fault. Now this railroad, right? It basically brought us into the water area, and it was honestly sick. Just look at this thing, right? We were going through this long, narrow tunnel, okay? We had no idea what to expect, but once we finally got there, it looked amazing. The floor that we were on was glowing. The ceiling was glowing. The surrounding areas were glowing, and even the builds that were built there were freaking glowing. It was nuts. And we honestly just rode the tracks all the way there. We found this really cool structure and decided to look inside, but it was a flop. There was nothing in it, and in all honesty, it was just a waste of time. We also decided to kind of leave the tracks. I wanted to check out some of the other buildings as well. On our way there, we also noticed that there was a bit of a pirate ship. We wanted to check that out because it looks sick. But first, we wanted to check out the castle-looking thing. Upon reaching the castle-looking thing, we realized that we're not actually alone down there. And no, it also wasn't Harry or Monkey. We had no idea who it was, so we were very cautious about it because at this layer you're able to commit murder. No one can come save you. Nobody. Worst case scenario, we get into a bit of a fight with them and they found out where our beds are. If they find that out and they break our beds, we are back at the very freaking beginning. We were not gonna let that happen. Nope. For now, we just let them be. We were still exploring around the town and the kingdom that we were at, but honestly, they were coming in our direction. That's when things started getting a bit serious. We eventually, after a little bit of time, finally found them. They didn't know that we were scouting them. We were just watching them. We looked at their armor and realized that they had full enchanted diamond armor. They were not playing no games. At first, what my mind went to was that, hey, we should probably keep our distance and keep carrying on whatever we were doing. But at the back of my head, I just thought, if we could kill them off, this place will be ours and they will hopefully spawn far away from us. This would be good because I did not want that anxiety of our beds being potentially broken every time we placed them due to these two. And so that's exactly what I did. I decided to take action and declared war on them. We set our spawn point underground. That way they weren't able to actually find it, hopefully. And so we decided to charge straight at them, but we didn't know where they were. We tried chasing them down, but eventually they escaped from our grasps. But one of them died, which meant that they went back to the last bed that they were at. And that was more closer to us than to their teammate. And that's when I decided to take a little bit of action. I needed to instigate the fight happening in the first place. So I decided to message him. I whispered to him and I tell him that we should meet up. And he said, stick to the tracks and eventually you'll find me. And that's exactly what we did. We waited there up until he finally reached us. This is when the mistake was made. Because right when I asked him about it, is the fact that he gave me one of the biggest red flags of them all. He asked me if I was part of the cause. I had no idea what the cause was, and I just out of nowhere said yes, because we needed a way to lure him in. and I had no idea what I was getting into. But before we could fully think about the situation, we decided to charge in and try killing him off. After we got a couple hits in, really quickly, he decided to slice back with his sword that also had fire aspect on it. So every single time he hit us, we were burning. Added to that, the lower amounts of health that we had, just being in these layers, made this task almost close to impossible. He was on a whole different league. I was the first down. And once I realized what the situation was, I quickly decided to shift. That way he wouldn't know the location of where we were hiding. Shortly afterwards, Bite came as well. And we were both just stuck in the hole shifting. He had a hunch as to where we were, so I quickly started burrowing downwards. But I realized no matter how far that I go down, eventually he will find me. I placed a bed down there for both me and Bite and decided to climb back up and said that we had a bit of an offer. He thinks that our bed is up there at the beginning of the burrow, so that was to our advantage. Once we came up, we explained to him how we were travelers and we're trying to get to the very bottom of it. And to our surprise, he said that we can come with him because that's exactly where he was headed. Something definitely seemed wrong because why would you go from trying to kill us to helping us out? Something was not right here. Before we realized it, we were actually a part of them. We were recruited by them. If we tried escaping, who knows what would have happened. But they outgear us by miles, literally miles. We didn't know what to do, and honestly, we were just held captive. We were hoping for the very best, that he was gonna lead us to the place we needed to go. And honestly, we had nothing else to believe in at that point. Hint after hint, we started realizing that we were now a part of a cult. The weird part is, regardless of them recruiting us, they didn't tell us what the cult was about, or what their morals are, or anything. All we were told was to follow them. They were also taking the railcart system, so we decided to follow them there. They had better armor than us, which made it a lot easier for them to navigate throughout the place without actually dying, because protection actually helps you out with the effects that you get on your health and your organs and stuff when moving around. My armor was actually better than Bite's armor, so I had a little bit of an easier time, but Bite had it the worst. Like, every single time he'd get that effect, he'd have to stop and place down a bed. It was ridiculous. It seemed very weird because the further and further we followed them, the more and more it felt kind of like a ritual of some sort. They were showing us all of these statues, all these really cool places where very important things seemed to happen. Everything was in the past. Nothing was current. We didn't know what was going on, and honestly, all these places seemed very surreal to us. We passed by amazing cities, and they also helped us navigate throughout the Sea of Corpses. They also showed us that there were plenty of people living here as well. To think that people are actually stuck here. We were honestly in the same situation, but our goal was to go even further than that. We were headed to the 6th section. Not many have went there, and nobody has come out of there. Once you're down there, you're stuck down there. Well, at least that's what the stories told us. To make it even worse is that they brought us to this huge, gigantic statue. It was holding a lantern, and it had red eyes. It was a little demonic looking, but apparently, it was something to behold. I didn't know how to feel about it. This was also another red flag. Just everything that they made us do just seemed like it was wrong. Something was wrong with it. You'd think that I'd enjoy sightseeing a little bit better, but this was honestly one of the strangest experiences we've dealt with so far. And we've dealt with some weird ones, believe me. We decided to look around further and eventually found ourselves a ginormous map of the area. The area looked so strange. It almost looked nothing like the upper layers. This place was a whole different dimension practically. We walked around a whole bunch and looked building to building. Little did we know that there was actually nobody on this specific area for some strange reason. Something about the area just didn't seem right. There was a whole functional city or town with a bunch of lights, with a lot of the places making it seem like it was touched pretty recently. Just ended up being an untapped area with no humans in sight whatsoever. Only us four. They told us that our destination was hella close. We were basically there, and so they decided to take off in the waters, which was kind of strange to me. I personally thought in the beginning that it was a bit of a shortcut. Oh, was I wrong?